Welcome to Christ the Center, Doctrine for Life, your weekly conversation of Reformed theology. My name is Camden Busey, and this is episode number 185. We have another great one lined up for you. Let me introduce to you today our panel. We have Jeff Waddington, who is teacher of the congregation at Calvary Orthodox Presbyterian Church in Ringo's, New Jersey. Welcome back, Jeff. It's great to have you in studio.
Good to be here.
Sitting in your spot with your microphone. It's nice right in front of the Westminster Assembly.
The guys, yes.
Who are on the wall. We're also very pleased to welcome back to the program our friend, Dr. James Dolezal, who is research fellow at the Craig Center for the Study of the Westminster Standards at Westminster Theological Seminary here in Glenside, Pennsylvania. Welcome back to the program, James.
That's good to be here.
James has graduated with his PhD since the last time he's been on the program, and we're very pleased to welcome him back, and hopefully he's not too intelligent or too smart for us now since he has those three little letters after his name.
No.
No. But we're going to run up into our own limitations, not only Jeff and I, but also James, because we're running into the limitations of human knowledge today, because we're going to be speaking about the doctrine of God, but particularly divine simplicity, which might be a deceiving or a deceptive title to some who aren't initiated to the subject, but we're going to be speaking about how God is basically without parts. And that's the title of James' dissertation, and we're going to march through that today discussing this very important doctrine of divine simplicity. But before we do that, let me mention that Christ the Center is listener-supported. All of our programs here at Reform Forum depend heavily upon the donations and the financial support of all of our listeners and our viewers. If you are able to help us, please visit us online at reformedforum.org/donate and contribute today. We definitely are in need. We have some expenses coming up in the future, and we would like to improve the quality of all of our programming, and that includes content. It takes time to research and develop all of our programs and to schedule the guests. It also, we would like to improve the quality in terms of audio and video quality, and we're looking to buy some new equipment here in a few months. If you're able to help us, please visit us online and do that today. We thank you for all your support, both prayerfully and financially, of everything we do at Reformed Forum and this program, Christ the Center. Well, gentlemen, it's been a long time coming discussing this subject. James and I, as well as other people, we all work as security guards and talk about this very subject late into the wee hours of the morning, because James has been at it for several years, as is the case for any PhD student, and his subject or her subject. And so divine simplicity, we actually have a dissertation in front of us. I've got mine in electronic form. James has his in gigantic three-ring binder form, and the library has its copy in bound form. And hopefully, in the next, maybe later this year, or who knows, in the coming years, we will see this in published form. James, I realize that you have some publisher interest, and so maybe any last-minute publishers out there would like to get their name in the hat. You might contact us, or we could pass things on to James, mail@reformedforum.org. But this is an excellent dissertation, one that is worthy to be published and read. And James, I don't suppose you want to toot your own horn, but I would like for you to speak to the present state of simplicity scholarship, and especially from a Reformed perspective. How much research is available now, and what's the general health of the doctrine of simplicity in Reformed circles?
In some ways, it's been rehabilitated, I think, through the publication of Richard Muller's Post-Reformation Reform Dogmatics. It's a prominent element of Volume 3 in that work. I would recommend for anybody looking for a serious Reformed introduction to this doctrine, the section in Muller's third volume is important. And what it's done is it's put the doctrine back on the radar, as well as other doctrines, but I think this one uniquely, because it is such a difficult and non-simple doctrine to understand, that it's raised some interest. So Muller has helped to rehabilitate it, but so has the publication of Herman Bovink's Reformed Dogmatics.
Yes,
the second volume, God and Creation, has an explicit treatment of simplicity, and Bovink treats it in sort of all of its medieval glory, and insist, even, I mean, here at on the cusp of the 20th century, insist that it's important that Reformed Christians still confess the truth of simplicity. Now, of course, it's always been on the radar in terms of Reformed confessions. Baptists, Congregationalists, Presbyterians, and Anglicans all confess that God is without body, parts, or passions. Yeah. I'm particularly focused on the statement that God is without parts. So confessionally, its presence is always there, though I would say on that note, sometimes it gets glossed over in the commentaries on the confessions, especially the modern commentaries on the confessions. It's usually very briefly explained as one of those difficult doctrines. A quick and usually accurate statement about what it teaches is given, and you hurry on to those things with which you're more familiar: God's eternality, power, knowledge, things that seem more easily accessible to us from the pages of Scripture.
That's interesting. We've spoken about the Reformed doctrine, and we have it in Bavinck and some other places, but what about the evangelical church in general? Who are some figures dealing with this doctrine, or do they embrace it, or how have they treated the doctrine of simplicity in the past and even in the present day?
I would say in the past, there's generally been a deference for the historic prominence of the doctrine. Even if it can't be fully explained, there's this sense generally among evangelicals in the 20th century that there's some important thing that this doctrine gives us that others don't, even if it can't always be named. And that hasn't always yielded insightful discussions, but it has at least kept it on the radar. Some have been better than others. I think of one good decent, not detailed, but a decent treatment of it is a chapter in Millard Erickson's book, God the Father Almighty. So there's one instance of an evangelical theologian who I think really understands the value and function of the classical doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
Others, though, Ronald Nash, John Feinberg, more philosophical, theological types like William Lane Craig, J.P. Moreland, see the doctrine as philosophically dubious and impossible and theologically unnecessary.
Hmm.
Meaning there's an idea that they appreciate historically what the doctrine was trying to do, but they're not convinced that it's needed for that task. Couldn't we just get the benefits of simplicity somewhere else? And I would say in terms of evangelicals right now, there isn't a movement consensus. I think to the extent that many evangelical theologians and evangelicals interested in philosophy have been influenced by Alvin Plantinga and by possible world semantics. To that extent, the doctrine is in great danger. I think that entire approach to philosophy in its very methods tends to predispose one against divine simplicity, particularly because the general assumption among analytic philosophers is ontological univocism.
Mm. And what do you mean by that?
We're already into the jargon.
We speak about this in usually the world of apologetics and epistemology in our circles because it comes up in Gordon Clark and Cornelius Van Til discussion.
We hear univocism, our red flag goes up.
Essentially, what I mean by that broadly is that the way that we speak about things like existence, essence, attributes, properties, whether we ascribe them to God or creatures, we essentially mean those things or signify those things in the same sense. So that when we say that man exists and God exists, what we indicate by existence is a single order of existence. And the things that generally characterize creaturely existence also characterize divine existence, except, of course, the certain limitations. And so that God is, for their way of thinking, the highest instance of being, or the highest instance of creation.
Uber version of man.
What I'm arguing for and assuming throughout my work is not ontological univocism, in which God is one among many beings, but rather ontological analogism, or an analogy of being, properly qualified, in which God is the sufficient explanation and reason for being, and is in himself the exemplar and efficient cause of being, but as such is not an instance of being in general, so that we make a hard distinction. Not a simply graded distinction, you know, up a scale of being, but a hard distinction between the order of God's very existence and essence, and the order of all creaturely, I would say this, similitude or likeness to God.
Now,
so that's Van Til's kind of getting at what Van Til was wanting to affirm by his stress on it.
Yeah, I think that to the extent you find that in Van Til, he has probably imbibed that from Bavinck. And I'll go out on a limb here and say that Bavinck imbibed it from the Reformed Scholastics, and they in turn imbibed a great deal of it from Thomas Aquinas. And there's my obscure statement.
Before we get into some of the specific chapters here and start to dive down deep into the doctrine itself, I want to ask you one question to sort of frame the discussion for some people who are new to this, people who might not have had a Doctrine of God class or read much on Doctrine of God. What is at stake with the Doctrine of Simplicity?
If
we get it wrong, what are the types of things that we're going to get wrong in other areas of doctrine and life?
In essence, what is at stake in the Doctrine of Simplicity is the what I call, in shorthand, the absoluteness of God. The fact that what God is and the fact that he is entirely non-correlative. That is to say, he is not what he is, and he does not exist by relation to something other than himself. He is the absolute sufficient explanation for himself. I think that's the most basic way I can put it. I think we lose the ability to say in any maximal sense that God is the absolute sufficient explanation of himself. When I say that, I don't mean that he's the absolute sufficient cause of himself. God is not self-cause, but he is that by which, or that in virtue of which he exists, and he is that in virtue of which he is any of those things that we attribute to him, so that we don't find an explanation for God's existence or essence somewhere back of God's own Godhead. And I think, I know that sounds grand, but I don't see how it couldn't, because in a certain sense, we're really asking, ultimately, what explains God? Now, the statement God is without parts is essentially to say that there aren't so many divine parts that sort of come together and together, bound up together, form the essence of the Godhead. The Godhead is not the consequent of many divine parts, but rather the divine attributes that we ascribe to God are simply explained in virtue of the Godhead itself.
Now, your second chapter here, after you've laid a foundation of the doctrine and its proponents or opponents, you come to a chapter called Simplicity and the Models of Composition.
Right.
What different models of composition are there, and can you help us to understand the vocabulary that's used? Because much of it is a scholastic, medieval, philosophical vocabulary.
Yeah.
How do we come to understand composition? What do these different words and distinctions mean, and how do they apply to created items, and then how do they not apply to God?
I think this is a core consideration. If we're going to even begin to understand what we mean as Reformed Christians when we confess that God is without parts, it's incumbent upon us to get some sense of what we mean by parts. What counts as a part? As easy as that seems, that's actually a very difficult question, because a part is not necessary. I mean, I think we can think of it in terms of physical things. We can think of the parts that together form a whole of something. Physically, we can conceive of that. You may think of a baseball team, and each player is a part. The team is the whole. No player is a team in himself. So we can think of it
Except
that way.
Ramirez.
But okay, well, you can find your exceptions. I would say this, and this is the definition that I give in my work of a part. A part is anything in a subject that is less than the whole and without which the subject would be different than it is. Now, that opens a plethora of what could of what could count as a part. Anything that is in something, characterizing it, that is less than the whole, and without which the whole would be somehow different.
Different. Mm-hmm.
Now, when you do that, you can begin to classify in a subject essential parts and necessary parts, parts and accidental parts. There are those necessary parts that have to be there for a subject to even exist. And I would I would say most basically those are existence and essence. A thing must be a thing must have an essence by which it is something, that is its whatness, and it must have existence, that is the principle by which it is at all. And I do make the argument in part that there is in creatures a real distinction between their existence and their essence. Maybe to put it simply, it is not of the essence of creatures to exist. Existence is something received by the essences, and the subject is the result of that act by which God grants existence.
The existentialists really came in and shook things up, because they would say that existence precedes essence.
And there's a great debate. I'll just go off track for a moment. There's a great debate in the 20th century between classical Thomists like Jacques Maritain and Etienne Gisson, and the modern rise of existentialism. And so you'll find books. Maritain has a volume, "Existence and the Existent," by which he is arguing against modern philosophical existentialism as radically unchristian. Mm-hmm. You also find a work by Leo Sweeney called "A Metaphysics of Authentic Existentialism," and there's an emphasis on authentic, meaning really that older sense that a principle of existence is what causes essences to be. All right, so you can see there's necessary parts, but then there are also accidental parts. There are things that are not necessary to your existence, but the fact that you have them modifies your existence or causes you, I want to put it this way in a more technical sense, causes you to be accidentally, but causes you to be in this or that way, in some way or another. An accident may come and go. The subject can only come and go in an absolute sense of created ex nihilo, caused to be out of nothing, or absolutely annihilated.
Accident, we mean something not essential. So, for instance, if I'm
wearing... Color of hair.
If I'm wearing a hat, that's an accident. And if I take the hat off, I'm still essentially myself. I just... Hatless.
Now, I think what you need to say with this, and this is before you get into a discussion of the parts, you need to understand the underlying relationship that characterizes every relationship of parts in a whole. The relationship of parts is characterized most broadly by what Aquinas develops as the composition of act and potency. Mm. The composition of act and potency is not just another instance of compositional variety that he identifies or that he discovers in reality. In fact, act and potency, in a certain sense, characterizes every other model or couplet of composition that we can conceive. In every composition, accidental or necessary to the subject, in every act, one part actualizes the thing, and the other part receives the actualization. The potency part receives actualization. The act part supplies the actuality.
Would you say that potency limits actuality?
Yes, and that's actually an important reason why Thomas says that God cannot be composed of act and potency is because potency, when it receives act, necessarily delimits that act. Now, when you talk about potency and act, you're not talking about things. You're talking about principles. You're not talking about subsistent parts. You're not talking about, like we may talk about, a physical collection of parts which may have an existence, prior to the whole. There is no existence of the principle of existence and essence prior to the whole. And yet the parts are discoverable in an analysis of the thing. This is, in truth, this is one of the more complicated chapters, but I think an important one to understand what counts as a part and why. You know, I almost thought of entitling the chapter "Parts and Why God Can't Have Them," or something like that. Mainly because parts always indicate dependence and finitude. And for those two reasons, because parts indicate dependence and finitude, and the composition of parts indicate dependence and finitude, I should say, for that reason, God can't have them. And Thomas works through basically six models of composition. And the thing that fascinated me was not that I found it in Aquinas, but that I found those models of composition so prominent in Reformed scholastics, and even in right. and even in later thinkers like Hermann Bavinck and Berghoff in the 20th century.
We should mention
still find those
in
those
many
categories.
Ways. Catholic thinkers, even contemporary Catholic thinkers, conservative ones at that, are much better on the doctrine than many evangelicals at times.
Yeah, Richard Muller talks about what he calls a Catholicizing element within Reformed scholasticism, which is to say Reformed scholasticism was interested in establishing its Catholic credentials in that sense, to the extent that we understand Catholic theology as the Orthodox Western tradition. Right. They were interested in showing their bona fides within that school of thought. I thought that was an interesting point because it doesn't seem that since the 17th century there's been much interest among the Reformed to Catholicize in their doctrine. They allow the scholastics to do it, and they keep the categories and they keep the distinctions that we inherited from, say, medieval Thomism. And yet I think there's been a waning sense that we could actually learn something from modern Thomas. But if you read someone like John Owen or Stephen Charnock, they were immersed in the literature of traditional conservative Thomism.
Yeah. Well,
and not just in a highly critical sense, but in an appreciative sense.
I'm going to say you've got reasons for the change. One being is that Roman Catholicism is not as if it ever was
homogenous, monolithic,
right? It's not.
Yeah.
At least it certainly isn't now, right?
No way.
No, that's right.
And Protestantism is, for good or ill, not monolithic.
Right.
But I think the scholastic desire to demonstrate their Catholic, their being in the Catholic stream, it was legitimate. But we're also, in addition to the changes that have occurred, we're no longer, they're closer to the split than
That's
we
true.
Are. And the traditions have developed a life of their own, apart from one another
and diversified within themselves.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, that's true. And yet the interest that I had was whether a modern Reformed thinker could, like our Reformed predecessors, find something. Maybe put it this way: find something being written within that Thomist tradition in the way that could help us in our articulation of our doctrine of God in the same way that our forebears were helped by the metaphysical handbooks that they were reading in their undergraduate programs. And what I found was, yes, that is the case. There are a number of current Catholic writers on this topic that actually uphold and argue for what, to my ear, sounds like a more Reformed approach to the doctrine than a lot of what I find among the analytic philosophers who even go under the banner of evangelical.
Right.
And again, there is a stream of orthodoxy that is sort of resurged in the 20th century within Thomistic thought itself. And what I wanted to do in part was to see whether I could tap into that in order to rehabilitate the importance of this doctrine for Reformed thought.
Well, I think just
it is beneficial.
Going back to Thomas and wrestling with what he has to say is a step in. Obviously, we are critical at points.
Sure,
of Thomas.
Yeah,
but,
sure.
But my own personal experience is that he forces me to think in profound ways I hadn't thought about before. And as I'm reading and digesting what he says, it's like reading Turretin in that regard, right? They're comprehensive.
The interesting thing is you do see that he has that same effect on earlier Reformed thinkers because in terms of his categories of composition, for instance, you find them reproduced in almost the exact same order with the exact same metaphysical explanations in Turretin. You find them in places in Charnock's Existence and Attributes of God. You find them in Bovink. You find them in Burkhoff, but you also find them in John Gill. Just to say, really, the Reformed tradition, even down to the 20th century, really has never broken with the Thomistic metaphysical explanation of how this doctrine functions and the categories of composition denied of God. What I wanted to do was enlarge upon those and sort of get at in a deeper way the original sense of those compositions, so that we could understand more clearly just what it is about God that we're denying. And yes, this is a form of negative theology. It's a form of apophaticism, in which what we're saying is God can't be this way, this way, and this way. And I know some recoil from that. But again, I think the assumption, even as you do apophatic theology, is the reason you're saying God can't be this way or that way is because of things that he has positively revealed about himself. Right. He's revealed that he's omniscient. He's revealed that he's immutable, that he is creator ex nihilo. And the good and necessary consequences and implications of those doctrines allow us to theologize in this negative mode, if you will.
Earlier on, you mentioned that what is at stake here with the doctrine of simplicity is the absoluteness of God, or God being absolute. In fact, Cornelius Van Til's dissertation, I believe, was titled God in the Absolute, and it was a criticism of pragmatism. And he dealt often with the subject of absoluteness as he analyzed British absolute idealism and Boston personalism and other things. So it's a related metaphysical subject. But can you define for our listeners what it is that you mean by absolute, and why is it so important?
Yeah, by absolute, I simply mean that for which no more basic explanation is not just available, but is required. So when we talk about God as absolute, we're talking about the one who is wholly and entirely the whole and entire sufficient explanation for himself, so that there is no explanation or reason for the way that God is, or for the fact that he exists, other than the Godhead itself. There is nothing. So when we ask, how is it that God is the way he is, the explanation of that is the Godhead subsisting as he does. Mm-hmm. And that's what we mean by most absolute. Now, we can extrapolate that into saying that he's absolute in regard to the sufficient reason for himself, but he's also absolute in regard to the sufficient reason for anything else. Nothing that is composed of parts offers in itself, as a composite thing, the sufficient reason for either its existence or its attributes or its particular mode of existence. All composition supposes a composer, and nothing that is, especially at the existential level of being, is self-composed, just in the way that nothing is self-made or caused to be. Nothing is the cause of its own existence.
So, like, if we're imagining that God, we say God is love. If we're imagining there's some part of the universe or some bank of attributes that God takes love from and adds it to himself, then we've presupposed that this bank of attributes, some people have called it a plenum, or that sort of thing, we're presupposing that that is pre-existent or exists independently of God, and we cannot say that God himself is absolute because he depends on some other thing that's out there to compose himself.
Right. To the extent that God is explained by virtue of anything other than or less than the Godhead itself, to that extent his absoluteness is diminished. Now, Westminster Confession 2:1, which says that God is without body parts and passions, actually ends the first half of that article of chapter 2 ends with a confession that God is most absolute. What I wanted to argue is that God without parts is the ontological sufficient reason for divine absoluteness. The reason we can say God is most absolute is because we confess God is without parts. as soon as we allow that God is a composite in any sense, we have to drop the confession that God is most absolute.
Yeah.
Because at that level, something at that moment that we drop the confession God is without parts, at that moment, we have allowed that something less than or other than or not wholly identical with the Godhead itself is a sufficient or more basic explanation for God than he is of himself.
Yes.
And at that level, he's no longer most absolute because you've discovered some principle of absoluteness or something that in itself is an explanation of God.
Mm-hmm.
And that was actually my greatest concern on the presenting level, was to say, if we're going to confess that God is most absolute, we don't want to just do that in a kind of unthinking way in which we are just in a vague sort of way attributing greatness to God. What we want to do is we want to name the ontological condition, we want to name what it is about God in his subsistent existence that makes that the case.
Right.
What makes it the case that he is most absolute? What I'm arguing is that God without parts is absolutely necessary to that account of divine absoluteness.
Yeah, that's a great point.
No,
great point.
James, a lot of what you've been saying in terms of God being absolute sounds like the doctrine of aseity. You want to delve a little more into that?
Yeah, what does that mean?
We can go into that. There, I do treat in one chapter what I call the theological rationale for the doctrine.
Right.
And it's important to say at the outset that the way in which we come to know or understand the doctrine of divine simplicity as Christians is not necessarily by the exegesis of some particular text of Scripture. And this is an important point. I think it's Confession 1:6 that speaks about the good and necessary consequences drawn from Scripture. What we're really getting at with divine simplicity is we're trying to say that God couldn't be these other ways that he reveals himself to be if he were not simple. God couldn't be the absolute sufficient reason for being in general if he was not pure act in himself. God couldn't be immutable if he were composed of parts. Therefore, the non-composition of God or the pure actuality of God, that's a more positive way of expressing simplicity, is itself a reason for immutability. Now, we may come to the knowledge of simplicity by way of immutability, but, and I think this is important, we don't want to confuse the method of cognitive discovery with a sort of ontological order, meaning we may discover things about God via other attributes he has revealed, but that doesn't mean that in God there's this sort of ontological structure so that, well, if I discover that God is simple by way of considering his immutability, it must be that his immutability is the ontological reason for his simplicity. We don't want to confuse the way or the route of theological discovery with the act of ontological subsistence.
So simplicity is the ontological precondition for immutability.
Immutability. Now, and I think generally that's uncontroversial with those that know the doctrine. I argue that simplicity is actually supplies the conditions of God's existence by which we can say that God is one, in the sense of not simply numerically one, but more basically that God is one in such a way that there could be no other. I made the argument that simplicity supplies the reason for why God is one in such a way there could never be another God. You want to know why?
Yeah,
because he's not because he's not composed of genus and species. God is not a species of divinity within the genus of divine things.
So you read this into the Shema, James? That
no, that's
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one.
No, I don't read it into the Shema.
Speaking in jest.
But yeah. I would allow. This is important though, because people
there's a debate over the interpretation of Echad there. One, does that mean the only? Does that mean singular?
That's the important ex professo statement in Scripture of God's oneness. But what I really was working from was more the statements in Isaiah 40-45, in which God repeatedly says, "I am God; there is no other." And He says it in such a way that His exclusivity as God what is the reason that there could be no other God? And I want to say that if you're going to explain it in terms of genus and species, the reason is because God isn't a species of a genus.
Yeah.
That's a simple explanation. But
that's
but
a bumper sticker.
But also,
that's the getting back to the God is not an instance of a category called being.
Yeah, that's right. That's the whole point that God is not an instance of being in general, or even the highest instance within existence or within the world, is important to this denial. Now, your question of aseity is an important one, because I think this is a little more difficult. Aseity is essentially the idea that God is of himself. We could say from himself.
Latin being ase.
Right, yeah. Ase. He's from himself, not in the sense of self-derived. God doesn't derive himself from himself, because God isn't even self-dependent.
Or wills his own existence, or decides
when,
to be.
When
what
God
he is.
Wills his own existence, it's not the will of efficacy; it's the will of complacency.
Yeah.
And it's the will of loving the way things are.
Right.
Now that's the will of efficacy and the will of complacency are important. God doesn't will himself efficaciously; wills himself complacently.
It would imply that God existed before he exists.
Yeah, that's exactly right. To be the efficient cause of himself. That ultimately collapses as an explanation,
John,
because something can't be before it is.
The silliness of such an idea.
And yet, philosophers like Thomas Morris will argue that God causes his own existence. He has whole articles written to this effect. Obviously, simplicity would have no attraction if you would believe God makes himself to exist. Aseity does mean most basically that God is the sufficient reason or explanation for himself. When we say that God is of himself, what we mean is that whatever we say of God, whether that be an attribute or whether that be of his existence, whatever we say of God is explained in terms of the Godhead,
right.
Is explained in terms of God himself. God exhaustively explains himself. Van Til calls God the self-predicator, not in the sense of a word of self-creation, but he does predicate himself by complacency. He eternally wills himself to be simply because he loves himself. Again,
so
not efficacy. Independency is often attached with aseity, right? That God is not correlative or dependent upon anything outside of himself. Now, often I find that this is given as the reason for simplicity, that the reason we say God doesn't have parts is because we all accept that composition of parts presupposes some external composer, and God can't be composed by another because he's independent. Therefore, independency is the ontological reason for simplicity. I actually want to argue the other way around and say that it's by virtue of the fact that God is without parts that he's independent. The reason God stands in need of no other and is not derived or identified by correlation to something outside of himself, the reason he's not is because of the fact that he is pure act, because of the fact that he is not composed of parts. And again, that gets back to my point of the way of theological discovery and the way of ontological subsistence are not
right.
exactly now, coordinated.
James, we haven't said anything yet, but what does composition entail?
Composition, in short, entails at least two things. It entails it entails dependence, and it entails finitude.
I don't know if this would be an entailment, but in my mind, at least, it implies or entails the possibility of disintegration, which would be connected to finitude and dependence.
On every level, disintegration, except the level of existence and essence. Because the composition of existence and essence is not such that could be... it could not disintegrate, but it could be annihilated. If you mean by disintegration absolute annihilation, yes. Composition of existence and essence does suggest maybe put it this way, a potency or an openness to the possibility of absolute annihilation. There's no reason theologically to affirm that anything is ever absolutely annihilated out of existence as such. Things are destroyed and they go out of existence at the level of substance when you have substantial changes and some matter loses its substantial form and acquires a new substantial form and matter perdures, as it were, through that change. You do have, in that sense, things can go out of existence or no longer be said to be. The dodo bird, for instance, has the substantial form of dodo bird is gone as far as we know forever. There will never be such another thing. But was that an annihilation? No, it was a substantial change in which the matter that composed the dodo bird has gone on to be the composite part of some other substantial entity. The dodo bird is no more, but we wouldn't say that everything about the dodo bird, its form and matter, were annihilated.
Right, but in terms of things that are composed are in this world at least fall apart.
They do, and I think the most important level is is explaining that the power by which they are is supplied by God Himself. So that the reason that things remain and don't go out of existence is the ceaseless granting of to be or existence from God.
Yeah.
So in this sense, God is not composed of, I should say this, clarify it, passive potency, but God does exhibit active potency. Active potency is not an openness to change. It's not a principle of reception by which act is contracted or confined or limited. Active potency can be regarded as nothing other than God's power, and in this case, extending itself to creatures.
Yeah. Now, James, next chapter you speak about simplicity and God's absolute existence. You've already alluded to much of this, but especially early on when we spoke about analogy versus univocism, what is the distinction between being in general and being and the being of God? And what does that entail for how we conceive of God and how He's different from us?
Being in general is created. Being in general, and even if I may say this, the abstract notion, the notion of being in general as an abstract universal, even that abstract universal, if you want to grant such a thing, is a created abstraction. The creator of being in general is God Himself, and He's typically those who hold a simplicity will want to say that God is subsistent existence itself, or ipsum esse subsistence. Yeah. The fact that God is subsistent existence itself doesn't mean that He is that general abstract being subsisting. Abstract being in itself, as esse commune, that is the common being or the common act of existence by which all things in the world are caused to be, and that exist, that general existence in which they participate. God is not the abstract, universal, general existence of things subsisting. Abstract universals don't subsist in themselves. They only subsist in things. There is no such thing as abstract ipsum esse subsistence, or the universal ipsum esse subsistence.
So you're taking the Aristotelian versus the Platonic.
Yeah, in this sense, Christians are better served by explaining the commonality of being and creatures according to an Aristotelian notion of universals rather than a Platonic. Platonism can help us on the notion of participation in ways that Aristotelianism can't, but Aristotelianism is definitely more agreeable to a Christian understanding of common being. Mm-hmm. What is the difference between God and being in general? God, as subsistent being itself, is the exemplar and efficient cause of being in general, or of that principle by which all created things are or exist. I may say as an aside to this, I think there's a difficulty here in the way that possible worlds approaches to analytic philosophy try to come at the notion of being. Because possible worlds talk about maximal state of affairs rather than orders of being, what they do, I think sometimes without coming out and admitting that they do it, is they collapse what we would have called an order of being into a single order of being, which is whatever possible world happens to obtain. So in their view, there is only one, there's only one order of being. There's only one maximal state of affairs which explains all or which contains all things that are. And so when you talk about this possible world, which happens to be the actual world, God is, according to that way of thinking, the most supreme thing within the world itself.
Right.
And again, I understand we're not taking world in the sense of the created earth or matter or anything like that. We're taking world as a maximal state of affairs. But in saying that God and creatures all stand in some coordinated relation to each other and correlative to each other within a maximal state of affairs, what you're doing is you're saying that God is one of the beings that falls within being in general. I can't see that the maximal state of affairs is anything other right. than a new and contemporary way of expressing being in general. In fact, in a way that I think does great disservice to the Christian cause.
Well, the language of being in general has been debated within my own field of Edwards studies. He uses the expression, and it's been disputed as to what he means. Does he mean God? Does he mean the created world? Does he mean a combination?
God is not that singular common being that is instantiated by particular essences. Thomas will say God is not the formal existence by which things are. He's the creational existence. He's the exemplar, efficient existence upon which things are, after which being in general is modeled or created as an analog to him. But God is not himself an instance of that being, and he's not in the world. I think this is where possible world semantics does not at the end of the day help us as Christians.
I was thinking
with
as
a creator creature
as you were describing that God should be outside of all the possible worlds.
And this is why a lot of
he determines what's possible.
Right,
this is why a lot of Christian analytic philosophers end up aligning themselves with the modern school of, which is more Cartesian than Anselmian, a sort of Cartesian perfect being theology, in which God is the top rung on the ladder of being. He's the top link on the chain of being, as it were. He's the biggest and the best thing around. But you can get to our knowledge of God simply by moving up a chain of being in which you find God at the top, but of course he's within that order among other things. So this is important for simplicity, because the way that we predicate of things then, Jeff is wise, for instance, there's a predicate. We would predicate of God the same way, and ontologically, the way in which Jeffrey is wise would become, in a sense, no different than the way in which God is wise, even if he has it to the maximal degree.
Yeah.
That modes of subsistence, between similar things are actually not a similarity of analogy, but they're actually a similarity of univocism. When I say Jeffrey is wise and I say God is wise, I say that under the ontological condition by which that is the case, that in virtue of which is basically the same for you and God, even if he has it to a higher degree, or Thomas Morris would want to say, even if he has the maximal set of compossible great making properties. Hey, look, now, and they call the simplicity people speculative.
And you didn't think the Clark Van Til controversy had contemporary significance?
It does. Yeah, the Clark Van Til controversy does have significance for this. That the debate there is, in a certain sense, no different than our debate with Plantinga and those that would deny simplicity today.
It's a perennial issue.
It is. It's unavoidable whether you think what you make of the creator-creature distinction at the level of ontological subsistence and orders of being.
Now, we laugh several years ago when our former president, Bill Clinton, made the statement, well, it depends on what your definition of is. But there are different uses of the word. There's an is of predication, the is of identity, and then I think there's a third, but we speak of that and we say God is love. You mentioned earlier, just a few minutes ago, God is wise. Now, we aren't speaking of wisdom. When we apply it or predicate it of God, we're not speaking of wisdom existing out there and then being predicated to God as if it wasn't part of him as if
God participated in some abstract notion of it,
which again would be Platonic.
Yeah, exactly. And so this brings us to probably one of the big sticking points for analytic philosophy when we talk about God's being and his attributes. James, how can we distinguish the attributes of God when we say that God is identical with his attributes? God is love, God is wise. How is love not wisdom?
And I take the route of just embracing the strong form of the classical doctrine of simplicity, in which we say, in shorthand, all that is in God is God. That's a shorthand, bumper sticker way of expressing simplicity. Mm-hmm. What does this mean? Does this mean that God is identical? That God is identical with all that we attribute to him? Yes. Does this mean that all that we attribute to him is identical, those things, those multiplicity of things that we ascribe to God are actually in God identical with each other? Yes, it does mean that. And it means that the attributes of God in God ontologically are nothing other than the Godhead itself. The love of God is not something other than the Godhead. The wisdom of God, the goodness of God, etc., that in virtue of which God is any of those things we say of him is nothing but the Godhead itself. It's not that God has a property technically being defined as something that inheres in a substance. Properties are, in that sense, always accidents, and essences are not property bundles. I'll just get that off the table for anyone who cares. The notion that God has his attributes as we might have properties inhering in us, when you have a property of inhering in you, let's say, again, I'll use Jeffrey. If Jeffrey is good, that in virtue of which Jeffrey is good is not Jeffrey. Because Jeffrey could just as well
be bad.
He sure could.
Oh, yeah.
And so that in virtue of which Jeffrey is good is something that he has received that is outside of himself. If you want to take an abstract notion of goodness, you can say that Jeffrey participates in goodness in general, and he is a concrete instance of goodness. That's fine. When we speak about God that way, though, when we speak about God is this or God is that, we don't mean that God is wise in virtue of wisdom. God is not wise in virtue of wisdom, and he is not good in virtue of goodness. God is wise in virtue of God. And wisdom and goodness and all these things that inhere in us as properties do not inhere in God as properties, but are nothing other than the divine essence itself. If they did inhere in him as properties, God would be dependent upon something other than his Godhead, in virtue of which he was whatever we say he is.
Yeah.
Now, what does this mean for the divine attributes? How can we make a sense distinction? What doesn't this mean to say that God is good? God is good, is God is wide, is God is love, is why do we even make these distinctions anyway? Why don't we just say God and hum to ourselves and say nothing else? Why don't we do that? Because God has not conveyed the knowledge of himself under the form or mode of his subsistence, but rather he has conveyed the truth about what he is in himself under the form of all these multiplicity and pluriformity of perfections that we find in the world. So that when we make the sense distinctions between goodness and wisdom and power and all the things in which we make a genuine sense distinction, it's not that that becomes nonsensical when we speak of God, but that we understand that that in virtue of which God is those things is in itself entirely undifferentiated, so that there isn't a property of wisdom causing God to be wise, or goodness making it the case that God is good, but simply that God is good in virtue of himself, and he manifests or reveals himself to us, complex, composite creatures, in a complex and composite mode. So that the true mode of the simple, subsistent, eternal God, the true mode of his being is not conveyed to us in our mode of knowing, but rather he accommodates according to our way of knowing, and he puts the image of himself in us under a mode of being that is fitting to us as composite creatures.
That's the archetype-ectype distinction.
The archetype-ectype should be brought into the discussion, but we need to understand that the ectype does not modally correspond to the archetype in terms of mode of subsistence.
Well, let's speak about that in the final chapter here, Simplicity in God's Absolute Knowledge and Will. This perhaps might be more familiar, at least a more commonly tread path for our listeners, because it comes up so often in apologetics and epistemology. Right. But what does simplicity entail for God's knowledge?
For God's knowledge, simplicity entails, first of all, as we've said with other things, that God does not depend upon things outside of himself in order to know those things. God's knowledge is not derived from things.
It doesn't learn.
God doesn't learn. No, he does in the older language, and I get into this a bit in my work. God does not receive in his mind or by perception the intelligible species or forms of things that impress themselves upon his mind. Knowledge is not impressed upon God. In fact, in God, knowledge is actually productive, not receptive. And what do I mean by this? Let me lay out a few things that simplicity means for God's knowledge. It means that there can't be a real distinction in God between God as knower, God as knowing, and the object known. Immediately the question comes up, but God knows creatures, and creatures aren't God, so how could you say that God is identical with the thing that he knows? I mean it in this sense, that what God knows in knowing is he knows himself. And he knows himself in the fullness of his being. When I say fullness, I mean the rich infinitude of his being and his perfection. And he knows in knowing himself, he knows the plethora of ways in which his being and his perfections could be imaged forth into non-divine things, or could be stamped upon as a likeness upon non-divine things. Thomas says, and I think in a helpful way, he says, what God is knowing when he knows creatures is not creatures directly, but he's knowing the participability. That is to say, I would say in a more reform-sounding language, the imageability of his own perfection. In knowing the imageability of his own perfection, he doesn't know the image as simple things. No image of God can be simple in the absolute existential sense that God is pure act, otherwise it would be another God. But he knows all the ways in which his own essence may be imaged forth in things other than himself. And in that sense, he knows creatures. Now, his will for creatures causes him to know their existence. Their existence doesn't cause him to know them. Rather, his willing them to be first causes them to be, and is the reason for his knowing them to be. Mm. So what am I saying when I say that God doesn't know creatures directly? He knows them actually in a way that is more perfect than knowing them directly, because he knows them, and he knows all possibilities through the knowledge of his own essence, or his own perfection and being as immutable in things. So that what he directly knows is himself, and what he secondarily knows by virtue of his willing them to be. When I say secondarily, I don't mean in terms of that there's some sort of first and second act of knowing, but that there is within the knowing of God concomitant knowledge of all the ways that he may be imaged forth. All that to say, what does simplicity mean for knowledge? If we're going to say that God is absolute in his knowledge, we have to say that his knowledge is not derived from things, that there's not a principle of knowledge that precedes God's knowing that is other than God himself.
Yeah, that's right. Speaking also in this final chapter, you talk about freedom, and there are some practical implications that we need to hammer out, or at least some questions we need to ask. One is that, how can God be free if he is simple?
I would say that I would challenge the form of the question itself, meaning at this point, I don't mind saying I don't know how God can be free.
That's a good point.
And
we
simple.
Need to reform the way we think about doctrine of God issues as well.
I think this is a tendency, especially among the analytic philosophical types, is to say that if you can't answer the how question, then you have no good reason to affirm something.
Right.
And I think that that is not just in theology, but even in lower sciences, that is not a good criterion for what is a valid truth statement. An example of this that was suggested to me by one of the outside readers of my dissertation was that it's similar or analogous to the way in which scientists will say that light is both a wave and a particle.
Yeah.
Scientists affirm that both are true of light. No scientist has yet explained how.
True,
but
right.
The inability to explain how, though it shouldn't be bypassed or brushed aside, that is a serious question. I don't want to treat it as if it's insignificant. But at the end of the day, it's not the only question that counts when it comes to saying that things are.
Right.
Even in the lower sciences, there are things like light, and there may be a day may come in which we can explain of light how it is the case, but sufficient to say the fact that we can't explain it does not in itself, as a question or challenge, jeopardize the truth of the
well,
matter.
That's a great point. Sir Arthur Eddington was the gentleman who said that what my net can't catch ain't fish. And that's kind of a generalized way of saying that if I can't explain something, it doesn't exist, which is silliness, I think.
Well, I mean, there are ways, though. I don't want to brush your question aside because I spend many pages actually dealing with the question.
Certainly.
The way I deal with it is more or less surveying recent explanations of how we can get the idea that God is free in his will of creatures and yet simple and unchanging and without accidents and undetermined in himself, and to say that God is identical with his will, the corresponding side, incidentally, of saying that God is identical with that in God knower, knowing, and known are identical is that in God willer, willing, and willed are also identical, inasmuch as what is ultimately willed by God is God himself. In willing creatures, God is willing himself, and it is the final reason of the will that explains the act of the will. So that we could say that God wills himself and other things in a single act of his will, an act with which he is identical. It's nothing other than God's own willing of himself. The question of freedom is uniquely difficult within that understanding. How can a single act of God's will in one single act himself with absolute necessity and creatures freely? I'm going to want to say that to begin answering that question, I want to look more at the nature of the thing willed than the act of willing. I'm not going to try to parse necessity and freedom, which are modalities. I'm not going to try to parse necessity and freedom within the act of will. I would rather parse necessity and freedom within the ontological thing willed. So that, how do I know that God wills creatures freely? I know that God wills creatures freely because creatures are contingent things. Because
right.
Creatures are composites, they aren't the sufficient explanation for themselves. Therefore, they aren't absolutely necessary existence. Therefore, it must depend upon God to will them. How do I know that he wills them freely? Because in a certain sense, simplicity argues for freedom, because if God didn't will them freely, he would not be simple, because he would need them in order to realize or come to know himself in his full self-identity. He would identify himself in correlation to something outside of himself and therefore not be simple. So in a certain sense, you need simplicity in order for God to be free. Modally, how that works out, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know how God exercises a free will. And actually, that was part of what I argued for, that many who say that they know how God's freedom is, how God wills freely, are working within a univocist ontology in which God wills freely in a way that is just sort of a bigger kind of freedom than the libertarian right. freedom we see all around us.
Let me ask a question. If God is simple, then is it even right to say that he acts freely? If that implies acting contrary to one's nature.
No, he doesn't act freely in that sense. The freedom.
That's how I think many people understand freedom.
The freedom of God's will is, I think, best explained in terms of the non-necessity of those creatures' willed. So that God is free in his willing of creatures because he is not dependent upon those creatures in order to fully realize the end or object of his willing, which is right. nothing other than his own self already subsisting. So that the freedom is more a freedom of indifference than a freedom of contra-causal passivity, in which God stands before a host of options, and there's a sort of moment in the divine life in which God could do this or could do that. I actually challenge in my work whether, in view of classic Christian orthodoxy, that we can understand and explicate modally statements like God could have, fill in the blank.
Yeah.
What I'm wanting right. to say is that though we speak that way, I don't think that we form an adequate corresponding modal conception of what God is doing in that act.
Mm. So we're wanting to avoid the notion that God must create to fill a void.
If God must create, then he's composed of parts because
right.
that thing outside of himself that he creates is necessary to himself, and therefore he's dependent upon something outside of himself to make him what he is.
Right.
Pantheism. Exactly. So the fact that I can't explain the modality of freedom within God is interesting. I will say this, unless there are those that think, well, that's just a backwater way of thinking that's never going to get traction philosophically. During my work, I interacted with Hugh McCann, who is professor of philosophy at Texas A&M. He has a book coming out from University of Indiana Press later this year. And I think his ultimate conclusion is that he thinks Christians would be better served by saying that God is beyond our conceptions of modality. And it's a bold move, and it's about as unhip as any proposal for the planning a crowd, I understand, who want to talk only of modalities. This is the important thing that I would want to say in that connection. Modalities are explained in virtue of things. Things or existence, things existing, are not explained in virtue of modalities. It's when we reify modalities the way that Plantinga does into a pantheon of modalities up there. We can understand the nature of necessity without even knowing whether a thing exists. Necessity and contingency are always predicated on the assumption of the way that something already is. The isness of a thing is the reason that something is necessary, and the isness of a thing is the reason that something is contingent. I think to the extent that that is a form of realism, to that extent, there's a healthy dose of that in the Reformed tradition that understands, for instance, the modality of God follows from the way that God is. Mm-hmm. And if God is incomprehensible in the way that he is, what makes us think that we're going to sort of churn out a comprehensible notion of divine modalities?
That's
anyway,
a good point.
Someone may come up with a good answer, and I'm open to it. But
I have, if I can ask a question,
please.
This is one I've been wanting to ask. James already knows because in our email exchanges I've brought this up. It seems to me that those who abandon the doctrine of divine simplicity are on the road to open theism. What prevents someone from going all the way?
Orthodox intuitions. I mean, in many cases, there are good men, many Calvinists who don't find the doctrine of simplicity convincing. What keeps them from really working out a system in which God is correlative to things outside of himself and in which God is dependent on things not himself? And a commitment to and a love for orthodoxy.
One could ask, do they have a right to those if once they've denied such a
ontologically basic... in terms of their principles, no. But often we will grant that people are
inconsistent.
And let's be thankful that we're all inconsistent at some level, right. in that we may very often turn out more orthodox than our principles or starting points may allow us to be. And that's in the grace of God. I think of men like Ronald Nash, now gone with the Lord, John Feinberg. Even in this case, I may bring up John Frame, who I don't think the first two explicitly deny simplicity. Frame, I think, remakes or reconceives simplicity beyond any classical conception of it. I think he just sort of he doesn't uphold. I get into a whole section of why I don't think he and others uphold the classical version of it. Does this mean that he is an orthodox? No, it doesn't mean that. He tries to, I think, insufficiently allow other conceptions to do the work of simplicity. Specifically necessity. What they would want to say is, look, all the attributes. God isn't dependent upon his attributes. God isn't derived. It's not that God's attributes explain God. It's just that God's attributes are necessary in him. The fact that he is necessarily wise and necessarily good and necessarily powerful, if we can just describe necessity to God, then that will be enough to ensure that God doesn't, you know, go to pieces. If we can just say everything in God is necessary, then we don't need simplicity to further explain why God won't fall apart or why God is independent. He's independent because he's necessary. The problem I have with that is necessity can't precede modalities can't precede ontology. Necessity is the function of the way something is. It can't be brought in as you can't reify a modality, bring it in and stamp it onto God and then say that explains his ontology. Rather, God as I am explains modalities. Modalities don't explain God as I am. And I think that's an important point. And I think to that extent, Frame and others, Feinberg included, in thinking that necessity itself can do the work of simplicity is a mistaken notion.
It just seems to me, and as we're wrapping up here, that the doctrine of divine simplicity is so intertwined with, dare I say, almost every other aspect of the doctrine of God that it's hard to deny it and have it not cause your doctrine of God to fall apart.
Yeah, there's many challenging issues and things we've spoken about today.
I make that argument, and I'm glad I persuaded one person. I know you were already there, but
James, thanks so much for stopping by again. The dissertation, God Without Parts: Simplicity and the Metaphysics of Divine Absoluteness. James, it's a pleasure always having you in studio.
Great, thanks for having me.
Yeah, we've got another interview coming up shortly, so if you're watching live, stay online. And Lane Tipton should be strolling in here soon. We could take bets on if he's wearing his cowboy hat or not. We'll see. But there is some publisher interest, and we're hoping that this comes to print and will become widely available in the future.
Amen.
If you are a publisher who would like to get your name in the hat last minute, send us a note, mail@reformedforum.org. Visit us online. Reformedforum.org is where you can find information about all of our programs. This one, as well as the Reform Media Review, Historia Ecclesia, Philosophy for Theologians. We have many things going on here at Reform Forum, and you can also contact us through the website, or you can get a hold of Jeff or me through Twitter. Jeff is available @RevJW, and I am @CamdenBusey, and Reform Forum is @ReformedForum. I want to thank everybody for listening, and we hope you join us again next time on Christ the Center.